Someone can tell whether my screen is seen to you?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay. So let us proceed with this ISE integrated software environment design suite 14.7 from the Xilinx. Why we are going for that ISE? Yesterday I told you people that the reason for going to that is one is RTL support. Though Vivado has got, this also has got RTL support, and it also supports low-end FPGA devices. So, and our main current ongoing course is RTL development using Verilog HDL, for which ISE is enough. Vivado is for HLS. Mostly people use for HLS, high-level synthesis. What is high-level synthesis that we have seen yesterday? So, coming to this demonstration part, yesterday you have seen this simulation portion. Now, I will switch to this implementation. So here you see I'm particularly addressing to those guys who are not familiar with this tool. So you must be alert, and in case of any problems you can unmute yourself and you can ask me to slow down or whatever. Okay, so let us continue. So here we have, this window is a design window. If you see carefully here, there is a design. In this, all design files will be there. Yesterday I was talking about some design files, some simulation files or test files. In a test files, we write test bench. This sort of code will be there, wherein we instantiate code here. You see this. I will zoom this one here for you. Some keys. There's the fake. Everybody there, if you see this HA, this HA is actually this in the design file. If you see where I'm hovering my mouse here, HA.V, here, this one, HA.V. This HA.V is a design file. And this test.V, this could be anything, but remember, in this file, you will be having all that test vectors. So in this file, this is design file. If you go design file, and if you see the name here, that is your module name. You see this module, after that module, you have HA. All right. So this HA is your module name. The module that you are developing, hardware you are developing, the hardware behavior that you are developing with this Verilog HDL is HA. So this HA, if you come to this test bench file here, you are using the same HA. It should be the same. This one should be the same. Technically, we call this one as an instantiate. Technical term in a Verilog HDL, the technical term is a instantiate. Of that one instance we are taking. And this UUT is a, you see here, unit under test. So this is instantiation name. This is given by the user. This could be anything. It shouldn't be a keyword. It should not start with a special the dollar character. Those rules in a lexical convention we have seen in a introduction one PPT. So those rules we have to abide by. That's it. And it is a user defined. This one. And coming to this one here, this you see here, we call it a port binding or port mapping. So these, there are two types. If you see here, this one, last Verilog introduction to introduction one PPT. So in this, somewhere we have that, port binding. So let me go to that. Okay, here it is. So this one here, if you see this slide, types of port association are mapping or binding in Verilog HDL. Several names. We can say it's a port association, or port mapping, or port binding. So there are two types, positional and named. even before touching to this positional and name. So let us go to that our one more this one paint software. So all this information, today's information is for new learners. If you are familiar, you have to bear with me for today's sake. If you are familiar, so this is for totally those guys who are not familiar with the terminology. So here you have this one, your half adder. We are giving the example of a half adder. So this half adder has got some inputs here and some outputs here. So we are calling this as a A and this as a B. And this one we are calling it as a sum. And this one we are calling it as a CO. So remember, this one here is a black box. This one, what we call, is a black box. Inside, what is their logic, we are not familiar. Some books may call it as a block diagram also. So block diagram or black box. So remember, inside this black box, what is their logic, we are totally unaware. So this, here you see them actually going here this way, the arrow is like this, and for them this arrow is like this. So they are called here, these are called primary inputs, and these are called primary outputs. So here we have, in this case, we have, suppose say, if you take full ladder example using two half adders. So what happens here is, in this case, if you are trying to use this half adder here, so you have got one half adder here, your half adder here, and another half adder. And then what you do is, you connect this sum here to this half adder. Externally, that carry in is here. So this is your carry in, and you have your A, B here. So, and this half adder is generating some carry out. So this carry out, this is actually going to the sum of that full adder, and this is also generating some carry. So let us say this one as a C1 and this one as a C2. So this C1, C2, you use one OR gate and you connect in this fashion. And you call this one as a your CO. So now if I put them in the box here like this, if I put them in the box here, you see here there is a S1, one signal. You see here S1 one signal, and C1 one signal, and C2 another signal. These are intermediate signals. These are intermediate signals, and these are primary. So that is the difference that we have to understand. This is a primary output, and primary output variables are sum, CO, A, B, C, in. Primary, these are primary. But S1, C1, C2, these are intermediate. So for this intermediate, if they are this S1, C1, C2, if they are scalar type, scalar means single bit, only one bit, if they are one bit, then we don't need to declare them. So at this point, okay, don't get into that, don't need to declare and all, just understand my focus was actually this one, primary input and primary output, so that I am making it clear. So from this example, full adder, inside we have S1, C1, C2, then we don't call those are the signals, but we don't call them as a primary signals. This is actually output coming from this HA, it's an output. And this S1 is going as an input to this second half adder. So this is acting like input and also output. And similarly, C1 is the output here and it is input here. Similarly, this C2 also is output here and it's input here. But still, we don't call them as the primary inputs, nor do we call them primary outputs. That point we have to get the clear. There should be no confusion about primary inputs, primary outputs, and intermediate signals. So with this, let us go to this one here. I was actually talking about this port mapping. So from there, let us continue now. So I hope this is clear to everyone there. Now let us go to this port mapping. Now I have this my HA, hop adder. Again, I'm taking the hop adder example. So I have here input A and B, and I have here sum and carry out. So what I have to do now to test this functionality, I described this functionality, right? So I have to test by giving various inputs to this AB. So one time I may be giving at T1, I may be giving 0, 0. At T2, I may be giving 0, 1. At T3, I may be giving 1, 0. At T4, I may be giving 1, 1. So meaning here, these are actually test vectors. These are stimuli. So these are coming externally from external some source, from somewhere to this AB ports they are coming. So this one actually coming from somewhere means externally to this, let us say you have something called here. Let me take another color here. So I put here like this. This is there inside the box. And there is another one test vector generator. This is I am calling it as a test vector generator. So this is generating this one, this 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. All are generated with the help of this test vector. So now the name is here for this X and for this Y. And I have here my declaration A, B. So there should be a proper binding here in order to evaluate. There should be, if I intend this as a X, and this as a Y, and I intend this should go to A and this should go to Y. So this is called binding. This is called binding. My intention is to ensure that this X is actually tied with A and Y is tied with B. That's my intention. I have to ensure that this X is actually tied with A. Likewise, this is there inside sum. Inside box there is a CO. So here I have another box, say this is there something mirror or monitor sort of thing. So in a monitor I have something here, let us say this is S1 and let us say this is C1. Suppose my intention is actually not that this C should be tied with C0 should be tied with S1, and this sum needs to be tied with C1. This is not my intention. My intention is sum must be with S1 and C0 must be with C1. That's my intention. So how do I tie this tying mechanism? This is a tying mechanism. So how do I carry this tying mechanism, knotting mechanism? So this is called this association, port association and the port mapping or a binding. So to the newcomers, those who are not familiar, I think for them this is clear what I'm trying to convey. So there are two ways actually. One is positional association or positional mapping or positional binding. The other is named association or named mapping or named binding. Either way, whatever that possible, you can call. So now, if you go to this example, just I'm demonstrating through example, that is positional I am trying to demonstrate. I have a code here, module, and the module name is HA, A, B, sum, C naught. This area is called port list area. And among these ports, some ports may be of type input. Among these ports, some ports may be of type output. So I have in a Verilog SDL keyword called input and output. So I am writing a keyword input and separating this, A, B are my input. So I am writing them here again. I can write straight here inside also. There is a provision in the Verilog SDL. Instead writing here, straight inside the parentheses, here input this space A comma B, I shouldn't be putting this semicolon. I shouldn't be putting semicolon comma inside here comma, and then output, then space sum comma CO, and then there shouldn't be any semicolon inside here. Close this parenthesis and then terminate with a semicolon. So that way also there is a provision. This way of writing is according to 1995 language standards. In the year 2001, several amendments took place. According to that, this provision is allowed. Compiler will not throw any error. Okay, now coming to this description, line number 5. So assign is a keyword. There, this output here, this sum, to this sum, I am assigning A, this is an operator to perform XOR operation. This tilde is a symbol. On your keyboard, there is a numerical key 6. If you press that shift and that numerical key 6, you will get this operator, tilde operator. This is a XOR operation, to perform XOR operation. A XORed P, and then semicolon. This is a part of the syntax, the semicolon. Assign CO, this is equal to A, this ampersand is again, that is a operator. In the Verilog SDL, it's an operator. So this operator A and B, this is actually basically performing AND logic. So AND module. So this is my entire code here, line number 2 to line number 7, my entire code. Line number 1 is this comments, single line comments are like this. So now I come here for positional demonstration. When you want to instantiate the above module in test bench or any higher level module, for example, binary full adder using hop adder, you will be doing the following. Module name, this way, this is the module name. You write the first module name. This is another test bench. Let us say this is a module, and this end module is a test bench file. This test bench file you have seen here. Actually, you should not be losing any connection. This is our test bench here. So this test bench here, let me go to this view and to full view. This one, if you see here, this is a module from line number 2 here, module test, and all through, I will explain later on, end module. This is a test bench file. Your module is actually this one. Module, hop adder, you wrote something here, that is your port list area, and the port types you have declared here. This is declaration area, and the logic you have declared here. This is your logic. Now, this logic is correct or not, to certain it, to ensure it, you are developing a test bench. In test bench, you give various possible inputs to the module. So this is your module. Here you instantiated the module. I am talking about this binding here. In which ways we bind this here. That's the concept that I am giving in this lecture, today's session. So let us come to this one here. So now here what is happening. Let me take this one pointer. So you have this is module name. You will be doing the following. You have module name, module instantiation name. You see, this is your module name, actual design file. In the design file, you describe some hardware. You give some name. After module, you give some name. So that is called module name. This module name, HA. And this is module instantiation name. So this is the instant, H1 is a instantiation name. Now what you are doing is you are listing out the ports here. This is the port list. This you are listing out ports. So how you have listed here, this one x comma y comma sum underscore result. This is sum underscore result comma, and this carry underscore out are ports in the current module. So current module is this test bench module. We are talking about this test bench module. So we started anything even in the test bench, we start with a module and we come with come to the end with the end module. So in this we have this you know, if you go to this one, your test bench, you have this A, B here. These are the inputs. These are the inputs. Why reg, I will explain later on. But these are your inputs in your design file A and B. And outputs, here outputs in your design file sum and CO. These are actually output identifiers. Why this is becoming wire here, I will explain later on that one. But at this stage in the test bench, you have your set of inputs here, you have your set of outputs here. These are this AB and some CO, these are local to this module, that is test bench module. Local to this test bench module. So in this PPD here, I am talking about the same here. Let us say this XY sum underscore result and carry out are the ports of this current module, local to this test bench. So now what is that I am doing is, I know here that is at X, I am keeping A, where in this HA design module, I am keeping A. I know here I am keeping B. I know this is the sum here at this point in the design file. And here CO carry out. In the design file, CO. So that way, having known that to which I actually intend to be this X, I intend to be with A. And this Y, I intend to be with B. This sum underscore result, I intend to be with the sum. This carry underscore out, I intend to be with the CO in the design file. So this is the position in the design file. So since I am following the position here, so this is called positional binding or positional mapping or positional association. So this is one sort of binding of ports. This approach is called positional. There is another way here. You see them here. If you see carefully first why it is and all, everything we'll see later on. But at this moment, if you see, first is a carry out is there, unlike here. Carry out is the last here. And thereon, B has come here. This Y has come. So Y here, if you see, here at the second place. So at the second place here, we have the Y, no issues with that. But this carry out is a last, right? 1, 2, 3, 4th position. But if you see here, carry out first position. It has actually first position. 1, 2, 3. At the third position, we have sum underscore result. 1, 2, 3. Third position, we have sum underscore result. No issues with that. But if you see this one here, X, here in this case, it's the first position. But here it is last position. So now the magic is here. This dot CO, you see, is a syntax part of the verilog. This you should not be forgetting. That is important. Dot CO. This CO is the identifier in the design file. Not in the test bench. This module and this end module we are talking about, this everything is in the test bench. Or in a file where you are making use of this half adder. You may be instantiating half adder in a full adder design file. We will do those things because it's a part of the exercise in this course. But here, at this point, this HA you have instantiated. In this instantiated module design file, there you have the CO and there B and there sum and there A. So you, now your intention is to tie this C O with the carryout. Anywhere in this here, this port list, anywhere you can keep this one without bothering about the position, but you have to ensure that dot is coming, first a dot, and then this variable. This is the variable, port variable that you used in this instantiated module in your design file. And then to which port in this current module that you want to tie with, that one should come inside the parentheses. I hope I'm not confusing you. This is, remember, very simple, dot, and this everywhere if you see dot, after that there is a variable, everywhere you just see dot and the variable CO, dot the variable B, dot the variable sum, dot the variable A. All these variables are not part of this module and end module. They are part of this HA. You instantiated a file here. This HA, this is a design file. In our example, this HA. Here you go back, this is your HA module. You see HA? In this you have AB and sum comma zero. Right? So now what you are doing here is, them you are using here, and you are trying to not with the variable that is in this current module. In this current module, I have carry out, I have y, I have sum underscore result, I have x. So now my intention is, the variable that is there in the HA, that is A, needs to be tied with it, irrespective of the position. The position, actually, if you see carefully, this A is actually first position in the HA module here. In this HA module, this A is the first position. In a positional mapping, that is okay. In a positional mapping, earlier we demonstrated here, in the positional mapping, we are keeping this X carefully where that A position is. A position is the first one. So we want to tie with the A, this X. So that's why we place it in its place. But in this, anywhere you can keep, only thing is you have to follow dot convention. So that's how this is called named mapping. So that way, there are two types of mappings. So why I have explained this mapping is, just if you see your this one, I was actually demonstrating this implementation synthesis. There we have gone for the simulation to see yesterday, this we have covered. In this yesterday's example, is required to be discussed. So that part I took up. What is happening here? Dot A, dot B, dot sum, dot CO, all are this HA module identifiers. And this A, inside A, B, sum, CO are these variables. A, B, sum, C naught. I can have here A1, I can have here B2, I can have here sum 4, I can have here sum 6. Now what is that I have to do? Should I alter this one or this one inside the parenthesis? Inside the parenthesis, because I said this is dot A is a variable of this module. And within the parenthesis, this identifier is of this local module. So local module, there is a A1. So I have to have A1 and I have to have B2. I have to have here sum 4. I have to have here TO6. That way I am actually binding. Now coming to this one here, we have to be careful here. So this to A1. And B2, I am actually sending this test vectors. So that's why I have to alter even at this point, this A1 and B2. Now you can see that way, this is mapping is happening. This is called mapping. So this mapping is remember, positional, the other is named. This is a named mapping. Industry uses named mapping only, no positional mappings. So this one, yesterday we have seen simulation. Let us come to the now implementation demo. In this implementation, we have several things to talk about at this point. Before getting into this synthesis, those points are, I'll take up this. Those points are, there is a line which is between your application specific integrated circuits and your FPGAs. There is a line between FPGAs. Here what happens is, you have your specification. You have your specification. That is, you know, customer will be coming, telling that I want a vending machine. If person is putting inside 10 rupees, I'll be keeping 5 rupees chocolates or 3 rupees chocolates. So if person is keeping 10 rupees inside the machine, then and also person is inserting how many chocolates of which rupees he or she wants. So let us say in this example, if person is inserting and asking only 5 rupees chocolate and that too only one, in that case it should give to that person one chocolate out and also the change 5 rupees. If another person are coming and again inserting the 10 rupees coin, asking 3 rupees chocolates and asking two such chocolates here, or one 5 rupees, the other is 3 rupees, that possibility also is there. Such possibilities, all such possibilities, what we call specification. According to this specification, designer, what he will do, he will develop a FSM, finite state machine. Basically, we are talking about tiny examples, but industry talks about FSM, finite state machines. This will see in advanced, in a syllabus I shared with you people. So we'll see in possibly in somewhere 4th unit, I guess. So FSM. So based on that, he will develop for this given specification FSM. From this specification, the RTL designer will develop RTL code. RTL code means Verilog code, and RTL code means in the industry. In industry, remember, anything RTL means anything that is synthesizable. Anything that is synthesizable. So that is your RTL. So this RTL fellow will develop. After developing this one, during this development, this is a, we are talking about ASIC approach. So what is required is, here we have to perform first of all, we have to perform functional simulation, what we call functional simulation. Functional simulation will not have timing information. Remember, this is something important, guys. There I am not wasting time. Pay attention, this is very, very important. Simulation of two sort. One is functional simulation, the other is timing simulation. This is a functional simulation. Make a note of this. Functional simulation. The other is timing simulation. Times you take consideration time. In a functional simulation, what happens is, for example, you have A and a B. Two inputs are there. And you are implementing simply this one, A ampersand B. So you have given 0 and then at this point 0, and then this is again 0, but this is possibly 1. So and then this is 0, you are continuing. So then you give here one step. So at this very instant of time, this is, let us say, 0, 1, 2, at this very instant of time, this value is 0, this value is 0. So I get previously some unknown, I don't know what it is. But once I simulated here, I get 0. So throughout, I get 0 here just because of this AND operation. Since this is also 0, this is also 0, this is 0, 1. So throughout, I get this is 0. But here, let us say 1, 1. So I get at this very instant of time where this is going 1 and this is going 1, I get 1. This is called functional simulation. There is no timing involved in this. But in reality, this will not come sharp at this stage. This one will come here somewhere at this point. At this point, that is after 2.01 nanoseconds some delay. So let us say this is the that this is this this one is that delay. This one is that delay. Let us say. So your actual output will come after that delay. This delay. Till that it is this zero will continue, and even everything will be delayed here. Everything, remember, for that matter, this everything will be delayed here. Timing, everything is delayed. So this is called timing symbol. Why that is happening? Shortly I will tell. So that but at this stage you should be having understanding of there is a call. This is called functional simulation, not timing simulation. We had developed RTL code. Now what we do is once our functional simulation is correct, then we go to synthesis. We go to this synthesis here. We have two types of synthesis again. In this, I'm talking about this ASIC guys. Make a note of this. I'm not talking about this FPGA approach. FPGA approach is different. So at this stage, we have synthesis. Synthesis of two types here. One is generic synthesis. Generic synthesis in ASIC approach will not take any foundry information. Will not take any, what is that? Foundry information, foundry. You have this Samsung foundry, several companies are there, no? So those foundry information. So this foundry information will not be taken into consideration for this generic synthesis. This generic synthesis will give us simple information about the gates, design is taking, suppose some XOR gates, and what is the interconnection between them, some interconnection is there, suppose something like that. And some output, some inputs here. So that information, this connectivity, anyway, it is giving us gate level netlist. But this gate level netlist is not dependent on any foundry. So now another is this. At this synthesis, we write a script. That script I will demonstrate some other day. That to give generic netlist. This generic netlist will be giving us this sort of information. Now, I will tell that tool, this time not generic, use foundry information, that is 180 nanometer or 45 nanometer. Nowadays, we are talking about guys 2 nanometer or some Samsung, I think. 2 nanometer, so 7 nanometer like that. So anyway, these are the foundry library. So this is this 2 nanometer, 7 nanometer, 180 nanometer, 45 nanometer. This is what library. For synthesis, we need some library, foundry information. So this library, who has provided us? Foundry fellow has provided. Now, what is that this synthesis tool is taking? One is it is taking RTL. The other it is taking is this library. Remember, in ASIC, this synthesis tool needs one new RTL input, that code input, this specification is converted to RTL, no? Code, Verilog HDL code. His Verilog HDL code and this library and constraints, constraints such as suppose say for example, just understanding purpose, 100 megahertz. This is the clock constraint, and we have something called I will just stop with this 100 megahertz, not because a lot of confusion otherwise. I will take up anyway. But remember, constraints also will be taken. So, for example, I want to make my design to work at 100 megahertz. My clock should work at 100 megahertz. So, such constraints. Those are called constraints. So, that information is enough at this stage. So, that is also given to the synthesizer. Now, what is happening? Three inputs have come. Constraints information to the synthesis, library information to the synthesis tool, RTL information to the synthesis tool. Three have come, right? So now we run the synthesis. This netlist is a technology dependent. Technology based netlist. Based netlist. So that is the point that we have to understand in the acid flow synthesis. Till here I stop because otherwise a lot of confusion. It is a called front end in this ASIC design world. ASIC design world, what is called this one, this flow, it's a front end design. After that, we start back end. There is a back end design. In this back end design, we have to place the floor planning, we have to carry out. We have to carry out floor planning and then placement and then clock tree synthesis and then routing and then routing. And every stage, guys, remember at floor planning, at placement and clock tree synthesis, at routing, every stage, remember one thing we are performing. What is that? Simulation. Simulation. And this simulation is time-based. So it's not functional simulation. Functional simulation only at this point, very beginning. So this is entire flow is a ASIC design. Okay, front end. So for this one till here, it's a front end design. Back end, I did not touch. This one is the back end. I did not touch that. So, but coming to the FPGA design flow, there is no such library here. There is no such library at this synthesis level. And there is no constraints that at this synthesis level we are giving. We write the same way the FPGA design flow is something like this only. Like a specification we have to have first of all, and then we develop the FSM if needed, and then we develop the RTL, and then we perform the simulation. This simulation is a functional simulation. Once this functional simulation is obtained perfectly, yesterday you have seen that functional simulation, that is. Timing I will demonstrate later on. So once this is done, then we perform synthesis. At this synthesis, the difference between ASIC and the FPGA is we don't take any library. Instead, this we take a target board. Instead that we take a target board. You take a target board. You are setting in your design here. This design you are setting here. If you double click this one, you are setting here board here. Spartan 3E. Board. So this in fact is made up of 180 nanometer technology, but not to confuse further, this is a there is no foundry like sort of thing here. We target the board here. So with this let us go to our this one synthesis. Okay, now that is essential because without discussing this ASIC flow, without discussing the FPGA design flow, straight going to the synthesis, majority of the new learners may have an impression that IC may be designed just like that. IC is not designed just like that. IC is designed these different ways here. This is one approach to design an IC. This is the second approach to design an IC. This FPGA design approach for the IC is a just off the shelf. We say it's, I see instantly it's available with us. But as sick is, several, as I said, it has to undergo all this, you know, synthesis and then technology dependent synthesis and then floor planning and the placement and factory synthesis. And there is a power also here, power also, power rails. We have to put a power rails. And then routing, and then open GDS. Every stage, remember the simulation we are performing, even in the backend. And then we open GDS2, and then this GDS is sent to the fabrication. And several things here I did not mention because several people may scare. The other thing is a DFT, design for testability. That also we have to insert at this point, this DFT part. This DFT part is inserted not at the back end. This DFT is actually, once synthesis is successful, then we ensure that there is a DFT also we are inserting. Actually, this DFT inserting is part of this RTL only. So anyway, this is so complex. I mean, not to scare you people, but not complex. If you practice, I can take up this as another session. I mean, once we complete FPGA, this current ongoing course, then we can start this FPGA. ASIC. In ASIC, I can take you all through this all from specification to this complete flow till GDS2 file, and then GDS2 file is sent to this fabrication. Fabrication people will fabricate our IC. So that is the entire ASIC design flow, guys. I hope you people got the concept. This is a ASIC design and there is a FPGA design. So our prime focus currently is on FPGA design, not ASIC design. So guys, there once I go to this demonstration, never ever have an impression that IC design is such a easy. Yes, of course, that is easy. If you practice, that is easy. But there are two ways, as I said, ASIC and FPGA. ASIC is laborious job, but whereas FPGA, people already that labor, they have done it. They just gave us a ready-made chip. This is a configurable. We can configure it. So configuring means one time 8086, as a 8086, this FPGA work. The other time, like a DSP processor. The other time, it may work like a 8051 microcontroller. So likewise, different possibilities are there on FPGA. So guys, with this, let us quickly come to this because we are about to reach, just 8 minutes left. So this HA, you have to select. See, if you select this project name, you don't see here anything here. Disappearing anything here. So if you select this device file, device name, then also disappearing things here. If you select your module name, then only everything you use. The new guys here, those who are not familiar, they may wander here. Once they click, array, where the things are? They may click this, array, where the things are? But ensure that you are clicking appropriately the place that is module name. Okay, so thereafter you have this synthesize XST. That is, XST is a Xilinx synthesis technology. Few people may say Xilinx synthesis tool, but Xilinx itself calling it as a technology. So you have to double click this one. So if you run, then it will take some time depending upon the complexity. So guys, it is taking time. So once it is done, this tick mark will come. So we have two things here to observe here. One is the RTL schematic, the other is the technology schematic. So if you go to this technology schematic and if you double click and if you select the second one, radio button you select, I will tell later on why, what's the problem with that, because running out of time is limited. So this you will get top level. Just I'm leaving like that. If you double click this one, view technology schematic, then the second radio button, you see there is no difference here. You see the tabs here, you see RTL1 and you see the Tech1. So I am just switching between this RTL1 and Tech1. Currently I am with the Tech1. If I go to the RTL1, there is no difference that you see. no difference at all. So, but if being in RTL1, if I double click inside, this is what you see this sort of symbol. So this is generic. I was talking about in ASIC flow, it's a generic and technology based netlist. So this is the sort of generic. And coming to tech tab, if you double click inside, you see here something called LUTs, lookup table. This LUT means lookup table. I will tell later on, running out of time. So lookup table. So if you see this lookup table carefully, if you zoom this one here, this one, let me zoom. Here CO, you see this CO in fact is connected to this buffer. And this buffer is connected to this LUT. If you double click this one inside, this logic we need. That is AND logic. That's what exactly we know that it's a small example half adder. So for the CO to implement the carry out, we need AND gate. So that AND gate we see here. Similarly, if you scroll down here somewhere, you see SUM here, SUM. This SUM is actually tied to this buffer. So this buffer is in fact tied to this lookup table. If you double click this one, you see the inside this is implemented. This implementation is for a XOR gate, this one. So guys, so with this, I conclude today's session because it took time because I have to clear the things for you. I just cannot continue with all Verilog stuff because one must be aware with the ASIC design and FPGA design approach. In the ASIC design approach, these are the several steps you have. So first is the specification, RTL, then functional simulation, then synthesis. In synthesis, you need constraints and a foundry library, and the other I said some more is required. No, three things are required. This RTL code itself. Oh, I forgot this. RTL code itself, constraints, RTL code, and the library. So you give it to the synthesizer, and then it will give you technology-based netlist. This technology based netlist will undergo flow planning everywhere. After every step, simulation is done, timing simulation, placement, and then property synthesis, then power rails placement, and then routing, and then finally GDS2. Every step here it is having simulation timing, and also DFT part is also very crucial. Without DFT, there is no IC design. Remember, ASIC design. Without DFT, there is no IC design. So remember, those are the complex steps involved. Whereas the FPGA part concerned, specification, then RTL, then functional simulation. Of course, here also timing simulation is there. I will demonstrate later on. Because this portion I did not complete. The way I drawn the line here, I completed all this, but the other side I did not complete. But telling here with this example. So functional simulation is performed even in the FPGA. And then synthesis part, here this library, these constraints are not taken. That board is taken here. And then we get that board related here netlist, that is in terms of LUTs, and there also we have the floor plan, place and route, everything, but this is a bit different. I will take up in subsequent classes. Okay guys, with this let us wrap our session. I just demonstrated today to the guys. Yesterday we had a glitch, some technical. So this portion, that is synthesis, how to do and how to see this one. And several things to explore, actually, number of slices, number of four input, several things to say here. We will continue in subsequent classes, several things, because it's running out of time. So guys, I hope you enjoyed today's session. If you have any queries, you can ask. I am wrapping today's session with this. So far, what all we have covered. With that, I'm just wrapping. If you have any questions, I can take up for 5 minutes.